One of the prayers that I've been praying regularly for my own self, family, and especially the ICF family is that we will experience an extraordinary spiritual breakthrough. Nothing ordinary, but something that is extraordinary. And when it is extraordinary, you know that you did not manufacture it, that it came from above. And when that happens, everyone realizes it was God. And I'm praying that we all will experience a spiritual breakthrough, a personal breakthrough in terms of our personal lives and our growth, and in our respective families, and as an ICF family. And God has helped us and sustained us all these years. And God has been with us even during this transition. And God has sustained and protected and blessed us and kept us going, moving forward. But we need to continually pray, Lord, help us to have a spiritual breakthrough. And in order for a spiritual breakthrough to take place, there needs to be a breakthrough in our faith life. Whatever God does, He does it primarily through the avenue of faith. He does not do anything in our lives apart from our faith. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, a very key passage, a passage that we need to memorize, and I hope that most of you have memorized it, where it says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. It doesn't say it is difficult. The writer doesn't say it is difficult to please God without faith. It says it is utterly impossible to please God without faith, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. And that is foundational, and we have to come to that place and saying, Lord, I need to understand what faith is, and I need to have a breakthrough faith in my life. Turn with me to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verse 24. I wanted to read the whole passage, but our time is limited. So I'm just going to focus on a couple of things for our meditation this afternoon. Mark, chapter 9, verses 14 through 29, but we don't have time to read the whole passage, but I would like for us to read from verse 21 to 24. I'll read verse 21 to 23, and then in 24, I would like all of us to read in unison. Jesus asked the boy's father, "How long has he been like this?" "From childhood," he answered. "It has thrown him into the fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." Verse 23, "If you can," said Jesus, "everything is possible for him who believes." Verse 24, let's do it together. "Immediately, the boy's father exclaimed, 'I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief.'" One more time, the last phrase, "I do believe. Help me to overcome my unbelief." Jesus had taken three of his disciples, the inner circle, Peter, James, and John, to the mount, and which is now known as the Mount of Transfiguration. And while they were gone, the nine disciples remained behind. And while the nine disciples remained behind, a father comes asking for help to the disciples. And the help that they needed was that his son was demonized and wanted the disciples to cast the demon out. And when you read this passage, and the disciples were not able to cast the demon out. And so as Jesus, Peter, James, and John came down to the valley after a tremendous experience, and you know what happened in the Mount Transfiguration, how Jesus was totally transfigured, and the disciples for a moment saw what Jesus, who Jesus was in all his glistening glory. And Elijah and Moses had appeared, and of course all of a sudden when Peter woke up from his sleep, and Luke, the medical doctor, is the one who tells us in Luke that Peter was half asleep, and as soon as he woke up, we find he sees Moses and Elijah. And all of a sudden, Peter thought he had a brilliant idea. He said, you know, this is a time to start a building program. Let's build three houses, residences, for Jesus, for Moses, and for Elijah. And then Luke tells us, you know, he was half asleep. When you're half asleep, sometimes you talk gibberish, isn't it? You don't make sense. You're not very coherent. And so he was sort of thinking, you know, grandiose plans, and mentioned, let's build three tabernacles. All of a sudden, we find the Father did not like what Peter said, and there was a voice from heaven and said, listen to my Son in whom I'm well pleased. And of course, it was a glorious moment. I'm sure Peter was waiting to come and tell the other disciples what happened and how Jesus was transfigured. But there was no time for that. As soon as they came, there was a noisy bunch. People were disputing and arguing, and Jesus comes and asks, what's going on? And what are you arguing with them about? And a man in the crowd, verse 17, said, teacher, I brought you my son who's possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of his speech. And when you read the King James Version, and when you read the same account, by the way, this is mentioned in Matthew and Luke, you get a composite picture of what took place on that particular day. And we find that he was demonized. And when Matthew records, Matthew says that this person who was demonized he was referred to as a lunatic. And the reason why they referred to as a lunatic was people in those days had the calendar around, they had the lunar calendar, and people worshiped the moon, just like people in India worship the moon. A lot of people in the Mesopotamia region worship the moon. Abraham was a moon worshiper. And so they thought that people who were given to idolatry and given to the worship of moon thought that the changes in the moon had effects on the psyche and the emotions of people. So when a person acted irrationally, it was because of the effects of the change of the moon, and whether it was half moon or full moon, they thought it had an effect on the emotions and the psyche of the people. And so Matthew refers to this incident as a person who was a lunatic who was brought to Jesus, a person who was acting irrationally. Now, people did not realize that it was epilepsy, and epilepsy, a person who has epilepsy is not demonized. And so we need to understand that. And Jesus sort of brings correction that this was not basically epilepsy. There was a spirit behind it. It had also robbed that person of the ability to speak clearly. He was dumb and deaf when you read the other account. And a person who was not able to hear, and when a person does not have hearing ability, it affects the equilibrium of that person. And also that person, he was dumb, where he made sounds, but there was no meaning in those sounds. It was incoherent. And so he had a speaking problem, and he had a hearing problem. And then we find the description, and a detailed description is given here of what happened to this disciple. When you realize how detailed this is, you realize that is one reason why it is recorded in all the three Gospels. Number one, we find that he was demonized. Number two, it affected his speech and his hearing. And Mark tells us, and the other Gospel writers also says, that he screamed loudly. He was a person who did not produce harmonious, melodious voices. When he tried to communicate, it was not only incoherent, it created discordant sounds. He was screaming and crying loudly. And, you know, it's not just demonized people who do that. Even respectful people do that. I went to university at West Texas State University, and I was in awe of a professor there. He was the dean of the school. But then I was invited for a party where all the foreign students were invited for a party where this professor got drunk. And the things that came out of his mouth, I could not believe. The person that I thought was a person, was an intellectual, respectable person, the dean of the school, and then he became a provost. And, you know, just foul language was coming out of his mouth. I lost all respect. So it doesn't matter whether you have high education or a respectful position or a lot of money. You can act irrationally when you are demonized. And we find this person was shouting but not making any sense. And his speech and his hearing was affected. And Luke specifically says, and Mark also says, this was an unclean spirit, a foul spirit. Verse 25. We read in this passage. And then Luke says it was an unclean, impure spirit. And whenever a person is demonized, demon-possessed, we find that person has a tendency to use foul language. And it sort of pollutes and defiles the atmosphere. And then we read in this passage that not only that, it brought convulsions. And the person, this boy, was falling constantly. He was breaking things. And it was throwing him down. And not only that, he was foaming at the mouth. Constantly, spittle was running from his mouth and was dampening his clothes and dampening his body. And he wallowed in the ground and he gnashed his teeth. So we find the gospel writer was trying to give a detailed description of what this demon was doing to this child. And Luke says was the only son, the only child of this particular person. And then Jesus rebukes the disciples before he performs the miracle. And Jesus often did that. And here the father comes and appeals, and in the appeal he says, I begged your disciples to cast the demon out. And the father is saying, I thought you had given authority to the disciples. And they said they have cast demons out before. Yes, Jesus had commissioned them, had sent the disciples before, and gave them power to heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out demons. And they did cast the demons out before. And so the disciples thought, well, we have had the ability to cast out demons before, so they thought they could do it. But somehow the 9 disciples together could not cast the demon out of this little child. And the father, he may have been a scribe, we do not know. The father is telling, I begged your disciples to cast the demon out of my child and bring deliverance, but they could not. They could not. I don't know what happened. Just because you are successful in the past, that doesn't guarantee you that you will be successful in the future. Just because you did something in the past, that doesn't guarantee that you will do the same thing in the future. You cannot depend on what you achieved in the past. You have to constantly depend on the Lord for grace for today and to be effective tomorrow. Their disciples may have gone on their self-confidence. I did it. I cast out demons, I healed the sick, we did all those things. We are 9 of us and we can do it. But somehow, nothing happened. And the scribe or the person, the father said, they could not. They could not. Maybe that's a description of some of us. People come to us asking for help. Either we say, I cannot or I will not. They come and ask us to minister to them. And you say, well, you know, I cannot or I will not. People come and ask us to do something that nobody else can do. And we think we can do it. And we finally realize we cannot do it on our own strength. Or we attempt without depending on God, without really seeking the face of God and praying and said, Lord, I need your grace. I need your help. This is a new thing. I need your grace for this. I cannot depend on what happened in the past. I need fresh grace, fresh anointing. And I want your Holy Spirit to help me tackle this situation. I need you to help me to know how to navigate during this time. And then we find the encounter that Jesus had with the Father. And the Father says, if you can, do something. If you can, do something. And so Jesus turns that question around and asks the Father, are you saying that I cannot? Are you questioning my capacity and my ability? And then Jesus turns around and asks him the question. The question is not if I can. The question is whether you believe that I can. Everything is possible with God, Jesus said. The question is not whether I'm able or not. The question is whether you believe I can. God is able to do all things. But the question is whether we believe God is able to do that. He asked the question, if you can, do something. Jesus corrects, says, that's not the right question. The right question is, do you believe? Do you believe in the ability of God? Do you believe that God is able to intervene in the situation and give us a breakthrough? Do you believe if God promised, he will fulfill that promise? Do you believe if God said, he will do it? Do you believe the word of God? The problem with all of us is the problem of believing. It's hard for us to believe. And the older you grow, the more cynical you become. That's why Jesus said, you know, you need to come with that sense of innocence of a child. To believe. I'm not saying that we should lose our critical ability to think and evaluate or discern. And children don't have that. And the Bible says that you need to instill that ability of discernment in the children. I'm not talking about that discernment level and that critical thinking that you need to have, but the ability to believe and take God at his word. Take God at his word. 1978, I spent 10 days with Pastor Paul Yung-Yi Cho. I was fascinated by his faith. He was praying at that time for 10% of the Seoul's population. At that time, there was 5.5 million people in Seoul, Korea. And at that time, he had only 120,000 believers. And he told me, I'm praying for 10%. And right behind his chair was in a blackboard, he wrote, 10% of Seoul. That's what he's praying for. He told me that the first day, and he told me that the last day. This is what I'm praying for. I was already blown away by what was happening. This is in 1978. And today, of course, he has close to 1 million people. And you know, there's no place. He requests, the number one request of the pastor in the church is, please, if you have come this Sunday, don't come back the next 3 Sundays. That's a good problem, isn't it, for a pastor to announce? But he had that faith. He held on because God promised. He was a TB patient. He grew up in the slums of Seoul. His future mother-in-law prayed for him and he got healed. And borrowed a tarpaulin tent and started the church right in the slums of Seoul. And he began to pray. And he began to believe that God will grant souls. And little by little, God added souls. And God has used him to build the largest church in the history of the Christian faith. The question is whether you have the willingness to believe. The willingness to believe. The question is not God's ability. God can. Yes, I understand he's sovereign. He can do whatever he wants. And he will bless us and he has promised to bless us. But are we willing to believe? Are we willing to believe? Read Hebrews chapter 11. Everything that anyone did in Hebrews chapter 11 was based on their faith with God. Abraham went not knowing where he was going, but he trusted the word of God. And even when he was an old man, there was nothing in him knowing that he is not able to produce and bring an offspring, and his wife was beyond the age of bringing children. He believed. He staggered not at the promise of God. He did not waver. He did not faint. He did not come to a place of not believing. He did not stagger. He did not waver. He held on to the promise of God. And when you hold on to the promise and appropriate the promise in your life, things begin to happen. Things begin to happen. That's when God begins to open doors. That's when you begin to see things happen in your life, in your family, and in your church. But the problem that we have is the problem of believing. Problem of believing. And the father confesses. He says, if you can, are you questioning my ability? Are you questioning my ability? And Jesus said, everything is possible for him who believes. Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. Help me overcome my unbelief. And I believe that's where we all need to start. Lord, help me not to question your word. Just evaluate the moment you get up. How many doubts go through your mind? And the words that you say, are they words of faith or are they words of doubt? When you communicate in your conversation with others, do you impart doubt or do you impart faith to the other person? Are you encouraging someone or are you discouraging someone? I do believe. Help me with my unbelief. Help me with my unbelief. All things are possible to him that believes. God wants us to understand that unbelief is something that God cannot tolerate. The reason why most of the people could not enter the promised land was because of unbelief. If there are degrees of sin in the sight of God, unbelief is somewhere on the top. Somewhere on the top. And Jesus basically rebukes the disciples and others. Oh, unbelieving generation. Verse 39. How long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. Oh, unbelieving generation. Jesus in the other passage is saying, you faithless and perverse generation. Being faithless is exhibiting unbelief, questioning the ability of God. And being perverse is when you have unholy thoughts, questioning the authority, the ability of God. And Jesus said, oh, faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. And we find how they brought him and how Jesus rebuked the demon. And then we find there's a time when the disciples come and ask Jesus, why is it that we were not able to cast the demon out? And then Jesus begins to tell them, there are certain demons that will not be cast out by merely your ordinary faith. You need to do it by prayer and fasting, where you are denying something that is good for you, that is pleasurable to you, but you are denying those things so that you can focus on God and pray intently and pray in a focused manner and say, Lord, I come to you and I believe that you're able to do it, and I believe, and you lay hold of that until that happens. You will not leave that place. Everything that is described here, I saw this happen in the life of a person who was a member of our church in Secunderabad. He was a pharmacist, worked for the railways, and his wife came to the Lord first from a Muslim background, and the demonic manifestation began to be seen in him, and he was brought to our church. He was placed in our house for 1 week. And he had several beautiful daughters, and the wife did not want him to harm the daughters, so they brought him to the church. For 1 week, he was there, a Muslim, demonized, foaming, and he would go and do the most absurd things that you could not believe, a pharmacist, an educated person. And I saw my grandfather, my mother, my uncle, all of them, and believers, fasting and praying for 1 whole week, and he was delivered of all the demonic bondage. The entire family, 11 of them in that family, came to know Jesus Christ and obeyed the Lord in water baptism, and his children and grandchildren continued to serve the Lord. The Muslims could not do anything. The neighbors could not do anything. And the wife did not want him, the husband, to be in the house, thinking that he would harm the daughters and harm the neighbors. So he was brought to the church and stayed in our home for 1 whole week. And night and day, 24/7, there were believers and others praying constantly, and healing came. Healing came. I do believe. I mean, some of the things, if I were to describe what he did, it would just blow your mind. Naturally, it was impossible. When you focused and prayed, fasted and prayed, things began to happen. There was a tremendous breakthrough. The entire Muslim family came to the Lord, and the grandchildren now are serving the Lord in that city. I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. And Jesus was trying to explain to them after the miracle, there are certain things that do not happen by ordinary prayer. You need to be very focused, very intense, and you need to come earnestly. That's when you experience a spiritual breakthrough in your life, in your family, and in the church. Breakthrough is needed in all of our life when you face huge barriers in your life. When you face hindrances in your ministry, you need a breakthrough faith. When you face issues in your own family, you need breakthrough faith. In the ministries, many ministries, or in our own ministry, I found when there was hindrances, when there were issues that were needed, finances, when you prayed, God opened the doors. God opened the doors. And when there is satanic opposition from all kinds of quarters, when you pray intently, and when you pray with prayer and fasting, breakthroughs come about. And you also need breakthrough if you are bored in your spiritual life. If you have lost the excitement in your spiritual life, there is something wrong. There is something wrong. If you have lost the excitement, if you're listless and bored in your spiritual life, you need the Holy Spirit to come and give you a push and cause that excitement that happens only when there is a spiritual breakthrough in your life.
Great is your faithfulness. From age to age, we will proclaim. Great is your faithfulness. All the heavens ring, and the saints all sing. Great is your faithfulness. From age to age, we will.